today, if I wanted to go from here, Shoreham by sea in West Sussex, by train, to here, Horsham, about 20 miles away, I would have to change here at Barnham, and the whole journey would take well over an hour. Prior to 1966, you would have been able to take a direct train from here, Shoreham, straight through to Horsham without the need to change. The whole journey would have taken around half an hour. So what happened? Hello, I'm Stephen Cranford, and I'm your presenter and guide on this new series called Tracing the Rails. We're going to be exploring the disused railway lines around the country, and the first in this series will be focusing on the Stenning line that ran from here, Shoreham, up towards Horsham. What you're about to see is a little demonstration, a taster, if you like, of the programme, and we're going to be taking a more detailed look at the old West Grinstead Station, which is about halfway up the Stenning line. Now, I'm in this little tunnel right underneath the A272 that runs between Buckbarn in that direction and Cowfold in that direction. This is where the double track would have been as part of the Stenning line. And you might be looking at this and thinking, there's no way you would get two trains side by side in the width and height of this tunnel. Well, you are quite right, because this isn't the original. With a bit of television magic, I'm now able to say that I'm right underneath the original bridge. As you can see, it's much wider and much higher than the one that subsequently replaced it. And if you were driving over the top of me, you would be going over a humped-backed bridge. We're currently in 1975, and you can see that the railway lines have already been removed, but the platform and the bridge look fairly like they did back in the day. But going back further still, you can see how West Grinstead Station looked back in its peak. The railway lines are here, so too is the footbridge, and of course the original road bridge as well. North of here is West Grinstead Station, so I'm going to take a look and see what survives to this day. In 1858, the London and Brighton South Coast Railway was authorised by Parliament to build the railway line that was to run between Shoreham and Horsham. And in 1861, on the 1st of July, this station, West Grinstead, was opened. It was called the 100-year station. The reason why? Well, it lasted just over 100 years, 105 in fact, before it was closed on the 7th of March in 1966. I don't think that tree would have been here at the time. The West Grinstead Railway Station's house is now a private residence, but it bears a rich history. Constructed in 1861 along with the station itself, it has the distinction of being the only surviving building of the six stations along the former Shoreham to Christ Hospital Railway. This station house, along with the workers' cottages, remain intact, even though the station itself was closed. Station Master Bartlett was resident of this house from 1958 onwards, and it was his job to look after all the railway stations along the line. Behind me would have been a magnificent footbridge, largely made of wood, that would have taken you from one platform to the other. Underneath the part that went over the railway line, there was a metal structure. This was in place to protect the wood from the steam and the ash and the heat of the passing steam locomotives. The Stenning line was never intended to be a primary route. It was always only ever a secondary line or branch line. And in fact, when it was first built, it was only a single track. The waiting room that would have been over there was on the up line. And it was only in 1880 that they decided to double the tracks. The original waiting room would have looked more like a railway carriage, but in the early 1900s, it was upgraded to a style we're more familiar with today. Apparently, according to records from the time, it was served by rather tatty and battered rolling stock. However, this line was very useful when the London to Brighton line became congested. It was an alternative way of getting up into London. Oh, how useful it would be to have that today. Now, the Stenning line was never particularly heavily used. Most of the time, it only had about 5 trains a day in each direction, many of them to or from Brighton. By the end of its service, that number was up to 11 train services a day. During the war, on the 30th of November 1942, a German plane bombed a train here at West Grinstead. It was a freight train being pulled by a Class C3 locomotive, and sadly, the driver died. It's remarkable to think how many old trains would have gone up and down this line. I think I've missed the last train, and it's going to be quite a wait for any future train services. Now, this is rather lovely. This is a running in sign depicting the station name West Grinstead. Sadly, it's not the original. It's been put here by the parish council, a rather lovely reminder of our railway heritage. I think it's rather charming. Rather charmingly, this old semaphore signal is here at the station. Now, this original one was at Partridge Green, but it was resited back to West Grinstead, where the signal would have stopped trains back in the day. For example, the daily fish van that came down from Grimsby. If you come along, why not give it a try? If you want to come and visit West Grinstead Station, happily, there's a really lovely large car park behind us. Now, this is typical of a level crossing gate of the day. This one, of course, was never actually here, but it's a lovely little reminder about how things used to look. Let's just check for trains and head on up to the goods yard. All clear. Now, about 100 or so metres north of the old platforms, you can see from the landscape here that it widens out. Looking back at old photographs, it actually expanded into 4 tracks at this point, just before we hit the goods yard further up the line. This railway was once a busy line connecting Guildford to Shoreham-by-Sea. It was built in 2 sections, the Stenning line, which opened in 1861, and the Cranley line, which opened in 1865. It was all owned by the London, Brighton and South Coast Railway Company. This incredible feat of engineering was carried out by vast gangs of labourers or navvies. Many walked hundreds of miles to find work. By 1850, 250,000 navvies had laid down 3,000 miles of railway line across Britain, connecting people like never before. Behind me is the site of the old goods shed. Freight was a pretty important part of this railway line's business. We had a local hunt and a stud farm nearby, so livestock paid a particularly important part of the things that were transported by the railway line. Of course, back then there were no cars, very little traffic being used by the road, so we relied on our railways to move all our goods. There's always been a fascination about railway lines and subsequently many publications, including this one, Life on the Line, Reminiscences of Railway Life, compiled by Philip Gardner. And I'd like to read you a quick extract. There was a large goods shed with a crane at the end of the up platform, and a signal box at the end of the down platform. We shipped and received lots of livestock, cattle, pigs, sheep and horses. There were special horse boxes with space for 2 horses and a compartment for the grooms. There were bins in the goods yard for the coal that came from Mr. Tidy's store. There was a brickworks near the station at Southwater, but not much traffic at Partridge Green. The booking office at West Grinstead had a large iron scale inside the waiting room and was heated by a small coal fire. It was L-shaped, with a ticket office along one side of the parcels office in the base of the L. That's by R.K. Greenwood, who came from Canada. Ah, now this is lovely. Always super when you walk the path of an old railway line to see a bit of track, but even better when you see a bit of rolling stock as well. This is an old Mark 1 British Railways coach, obviously done many miles in its lifetime, but sadly going no further. What's interesting though is that it's parked up in a little spur that was once used for unloading cattle. Behind would have been white painted cattle pens, and the cattle would have been loaded onto and off the train at this point. And there's also this lovely old wall. You can see from the original maps and drawings that this was part of the old goods yard. This is the loading dock, where the coaches now located. Vans that could take long items were positioned. Pens for sheep and cattle were kept at the far end, and horse boxes were kept at the eastern face of the dock. Now in this photo there's an Ivatt loco which is pulling the 1330 Brighton to Horsham train just leaving West Grinstead. This was taken on the 30th of April 1964. The photograph shows part of the track layout just to the north of the station. The non-passenger traffic from West Grinstead consisted of horse boxes serving nearby racing stables. Primroses were so prolific that people would hop off one train to gather them, then catch the next train to sell them at markets. Today the flowers, which bloom in early spring, provide a beautiful display on the old embankments. You might see quite a few of these along a railway line. It's called a gradient marker, and you're not imagining it. It is actually on the wonk, because the significant part is the numbers and also the angle of the sign. This side of the post, it says 362 and it's pointing downhill. That side of the post, it says 132 and it's pointing uphill. These numbers represent how many feet you have to travel to go up or down by 1 foot. So this side here, which points in towards West Grinstead Station, is 362 feet along to go 1 foot down, so quite a shallow gradient. The other side is a little steeper, 132 feet along to go up one. Now, why are these numbers important? If you think of the weight of a steam train, particularly heavy loaded with freight or coal or passengers, it's important for the driver to know how far they've got if they're braking to come into a station. Equally, if they're pulling up a gradient, how much steam pressure will be needed to climb up the hill. All those numbers meant something to the drivers along the route. Always be vigilant if you're out and about on an old railway route, because you will always spot things that may have something to do with trains, such as this, for example, which is a level marker. It's got numbers to the side here, 2 1/4 in this instance, and on my side, 17. Now, if you follow me through here, this shows further evidence of the old goods yard. Along here, you can see the old brick wall, which is where the trains would have run up and down here, and the goods would have been unloaded. Amazing, look how overgrown it all is. And that brickwork, 170 years old, something like that. The people who built it certainly knew their stuff. Now, what's interesting, up on this embankment, I can see some fencing. This is a fence that's been put up in the style of the old London, Brighton, South Coast fencing that they used to have at the edge of the goods yard. Well, what's interesting, we've got the other railway lines there, but down here, this was a private siding that was used by the nearby brick kilns. They had coal deliveries, especially for their brick kilns, which needed enormous amounts of heat to fire those bricks. And it's wonderful to see that 170 years later, these rails are still in place. Of course, very overgrown now. It's quite rare to still see lines because most of them were ripped up, but it's a little glimpse of how things would have been. course, we worry about leaves on the line now. This takes it one step further, doesn't it, with all these trees and bushes overtaking the line. But keep your eyes peeled. You never know what you'll see. Look at the size of this tree growing on the railway line. It does just go to show, doesn't it, how many years it is since any rolling stock went up and down these rails. So what do I think walking around amongst all these old ghostly relics? To be honest, I find it all rather sad. Dr. Beeching made sweeping cuts across the country in the 60s, closing down redundant railway lines such as this one. And the Stenning line closed formally on the 7th of March 1966. Freight services had stopped in the early 60s, before Kennedy was assassinated or William Hartnell stepped aboard the TARDIS, and the final passenger train was on the 5th of March 1966. Rather poignantly, the very final train to ever run on the Stenning line was on Sunday, March the 6th. Just after midnight, it left Bramber and made its way up the line, collecting all the platform furniture on its way up to Christ Hospital. Thereafter, all the furniture was dumped as a final gesture for the line that was to be closed. It's all rather sad.
Oh, Mr. Porter, what shall I do? I want to go to Birmingham and they're taking me on to crew. Send me back to London as quickly as you can. Oh, Mr. Porter, what a silly girl I am. The porter would not stop the train, but laughed and said, you must. Keep your hair on, Mary Ann, and mind that you don't bust.
So, do you have any old photos, films, or memories of the Stenning line or any other disused railway line around Sussex? If so, we'd love to hear from you. This is an exciting opportunity where your material and memories could end up on future episodes. If you think you can, why not email us at info@tracingtherails.com. Don't forget to click and subscribe or scan the QR code, or why not email info@tracingtherails.com.